Shalom and welcome again to Israel's Hope Bible Church Online. My name is Ron Grossman and we're continuing in our studies in the book of Hebrews. We're picking up in the middle, towards the end of chapter 9 of the book of Hebrews. So if you have your Bibles, get them out and open them up to chapter 9. We're going to start at verse 25, which we're going to deal with until the end of the chapter. A little bit of revision so that we can make sure that we're connected to what we've been talking about so far. Before we get going, let's pray and ask the Holy Spirit to direct us. Father God, thank you again for each person here that's looking in today. And we ask now that you'd bless the time that you have given us, that it would be for your glory and honor. Thank you for allowing us to serve in this way. We ask now for your hand upon this ministry as we go forward and pray this all now in Jesus' name. Amen. So follow with me, please, as we read, starting in verse 25 of Hebrews chapter 9. It says this, "Nor yet that he should offer himself often as the high priest enters into the holy place every year with blood of others. For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world. But now in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation." So we can entitle this passage today that we're looking at is, who are you looking for and what are you looking for? The whole time in verses in chapters 7, 8, and 9, the comparison to the old covenant, the old house is being made and expanded upon. And throughout, the writer is talking about how the old covenant, the priesthood of Israel, the Aaronic priesthood, has been superseded, has been improved upon it in basics, by the fact that Jesus, the promised Messiah, who came at the right time in history, came of the right family background, came and did what was required of him, which was to pay the penalty for sin. And he did all of this, and now we have been shown that previous to this, the priesthood brought offerings that were acceptable to God. If the priest himself brought an offering for himself first, asked for the forgiveness of any of his sin, and then once that was done, was able to bring the sin offering for the people. And this was the covenant promise between God and Israel. If you wanted to have access to God prior to the Messiah's coming, you had to identify with the people of the house of Israel. The thing is, now the church age has begun. And as we are looking at in the book of Acts, in our other midweek study, we're seeing that they're transitioning out of the old covenant into the new covenant, not because there was anything wrong with the old covenant, except this. It could only bring temporary fulfillment of forgiveness of sin. It was temporary and would have to be done on a daily basis. I remember in our studies of Hebrews when I was in Bible school, our instructor told us this, that you could not find a chair in the temple in Jerusalem. There were no chairs. There was nowhere to sit down. And the reason why is because the priests were continuously bringing an offering for forgiveness over and over. The work was continuous. It never stopped. But Jesus did everything that needed to be done one time only, and it has been fulfilled in the person of Jesus. So that is what has been dealt with here. We looked in the previous portion. We started, studying last time, leading up to this end portion of chapter 9, that he is, Jesus, the mediator of a new testament, a new covenant. This is a new covenant that has been built upon. So let's go now, and we're actually going to start at verse 24, just to overlap a little bit, where it says this, "For Christ has not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us." This takes us all the way back, as I said last time, to Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 to 4, where Jesus is pictured for us as sitting at the right hand of God the Father on high. He sits waiting for God the Father to say, go retrieve the church. That is what we call the rapture of the church. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. And that is coming. Perhaps some of you who are looking in don't hold to the rapture of the church, and you think that the church is going to be here for portions of the tribulation period or all of it. Well, I would disagree with you. God has given us a way out, just as he gave Noah and his family a way out when he was going to judge planet Earth in the flood, and he did. And anyone could have gotten on that boat along with Noah and his family if they wanted to. They chose not. Now, it's not that you're not born again if you don't believe in the rapture. Yes, you are. And as I always kind of tongue-in-cheek say, you're going to go on the rapture, whether you like it or not. We are at the point now where we wait, and the doctrine of imminency is in full play in that respect. Imminency, the imminent at any time return of Messiah for you, for me, who are followers of Jesus as Messiah, who have asked him into our lives as personal Savior, have asked to be born again as Jesus instructed Nicodemus in John chapter 3. And if you have done that, you have the absolute assurance of your spending an eternity with God. You're going to be with God forever. He'll come for us, the church, God's called out people, Jewish and Gentile alike. He'll come for us, and he will take us to be with him. So we started, we're reading actually and studying verses 25 till the end of the chapter, but verse 24 is important. Because Jesus did not enter into a holy place made with human hands. This is the contrast. That's the old house. Jesus came into a different holy of holies, and that was on a Roman cross, willingly going there without a blood offering except for himself. His death on that cross was the payment for your sin, my sin, but you need to be born again. You need to ask Jesus into your heart, into your life. You need to admit you're a sinner. You need to admit you'll never earn your own way to heaven. And if you can do that and realize that your sin precludes you from being able to justify yourself before God, know this. God has justified you simply by believing by faith in who Jesus is. The definition of faith is coming up in our studies in this book in Hebrews 11, verse 1. You can go ahead and look at that if you wish. Now, in verse 25, he goes on here to say that he's not entering often. Not that he should offer himself often as the high priest enters into the holy place every year with the blood of others. Now, this holy place, is one way of saying it literally, is the most holy place, the holy place every year. So this would be the annual Yom Kippur sacrifice made on behalf of the whole nation of Israel. And he need not do that, not just for Israel, but also for any other nation group of people. He's not entering often on a yearly basis as the high priest did. And the reason for this is because, look at verse 26, for then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world? But now, once in the end of the world, hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. He put away sin. And he has done this by himself. It's in at the end of the world. Now, a lot of people will get a little bit upset with that, and they say, the end of the world? Well, the world is still here. How is this the end of the world? Well, we're in the end times. We have been in the end times since Jesus ascended to heaven way back in the beginning of the book of Acts, chapter 1. And we wait with imminency, with imminent waiting for his return. He could come at any moment. That's what imminency means. He could come at any moment. Are you ready to meet him? The world here is the age that we're living in. It's the same word that's used in Matthew chapter 28, verses 18, 19, and 20, where Jesus says, go out and make disciples of all the nations, teaching them and baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And he then promises, I am with you until the end of the age. The word in the Greek there means the age or the period of time that is designated for for going out and making disciples of all the nations, the church age. The world has not come to an end yet. And what's interesting about our world that we live in is that even though all of the climate change people are saying what they're saying and how we have limited time and all the rest, it should not give us the sense that we have the freedom to then pollute as we would wish. I'm a biblical environmentalist, by the way. I believe that we have a responsibility to properly take care of the world that God has given to us. Go back to Genesis 1 and 2. God created Adam and he gave him a garden, a place to live, and he said, take care of that garden. It's no different than any garden, perhaps in some respects, that you may have attached to your own property, where you may put in your own vegetables in the summer or even flowers to make the outside of your house look good. You do that because what you want to do is you want to make certain that your home looks a certain way, that it has a certain appearance, and God gave us a home. It's this planet. The world is not going to end. Even at the end of the events of the book of Revelation, where the last Armageddon battle takes place, just prior to Jesus coming to set up his kingdom here on this very same earth, Ezekiel the prophet describes how living waters are going to flow out of the millennial temple in Jerusalem. They'll flow out to the east and to the west. And when they do that, they will be living waters that will go to the west, and that will be the Mediterranean Sea, because it goes to the West Sea, and then it's going to go to the Hinder Sea, as Ezekiel describes it. That I believe to be the Dead Sea. And the Dead Sea has been dead water, and I believe, since the judgment of Sodom and Gomorrah. And the living water that's going to come out of the temple in Jerusalem is going to go into that water in the Dead Sea and revitalize it. It's going to go into the water of the Mediterranean, which will then open up and through the Straits of Gibraltar out to the Atlantic Ocean, eventually covering all the major waterways of the earth. And the reason why that's going to need to happen is because if you read in the book of Revelation, the waters of the earth are going to be turned into blood. Very similar to what Moses did with the Nile and Egypt at the time of the Exodus. The Nile River turned into blood. The Egyptians lived by the Nile. The water was used to irrigate their crops. The water was used for literally surviving. And what did God do? He turned that water into blood and everything in it died. And during the tribulation period, the water of planet Earth is going to become bitter. It's going to be turned into blood. And what's God going to do in the person of Jesus? He's going to restore this world that we live in. This is the world, or the age of verse 26 that's being spoken about here, the end of the age, the church age. When the church is raptured, we are removed. The church age ends. Will come after that, what will come will be some period of time after the removal of the church. It's not immediate. There's nothing in the scriptures that says that the church is removed and the seven-year tribulation period begins immediately. That's not what happens. Sometime after the church is removed, sometime then, will come the time of Jacob's trouble, as Jeremiah the prophet describes it as. The Antichrist will rise up. The Antichrist eventually will make a peace treaty with Israel, guaranteeing Israel peace, will then subjugate the world under his control, but there will still be people who will turn to Jesus during that time. I've always said it like this: the absence of believers, the absence of Christians after the church has been removed is going to speak volumes to people. How many people have you told who are not followers of Jesus about the rapture? If you haven't, well, you can if you wish. Some people would dismiss it anyways, might even laugh at you. But what I'm leaving behind here on these videos is evidence for people to look at once we are gone. I remember meeting a fellow in Calgary, Alberta, about 30 years ago now. And he came to me that day at a conference I had been called out to speak at. And he asked me if I needed a computer. He thought the world, because of the Middle East war at that time in 1990, he thought the world was coming to an end. He wanted to get computers into the hands of people who were teaching and preaching the scriptures. And he actually gave me a computer that was cutting edge for the time. I thought we wouldn't need a new computer for years after that. Within 2 years, it was so out of date anyways, but it's not the point. And his thinking was this, is that we can leave evidence behind on the computer systems that are being developed now. We can leave evidence behind. So once we are gone, the evidence of what we teach from the scriptures, what we hold to from the scriptures, will still be available. And people will be able to find information about turning to Jesus. I may go to heaven in the rapture. And if I'm alive, physically alive, when God comes to take us out of here, that'll be great. But I do not think I'm going to be taking this. How many of you own a Bible or two or three? I usually have a good number of them on hand. I mark them up and put notes in them, and then eventually someone tells me they need a new Bible and I give it to them. And there's information again that's going to be passed around to different people. So you see, the end of the world. This has happened now once in the end of the world. Since the time of Jesus' ascension to heaven, we have been at the end, on the cusp of the end of time. Like imminency teaches, it could happen at any time. And he has appeared at the end of the world, Jesus, look at verse 26, to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Jesus putting away of sin by the sacrifice of himself. As I've said to you in previous weeks and other times when I teach this, the most amazing thing that God ever did was becoming a human being like you and I, and willingly allowing himself, look at verse 26, to become a sacrifice of himself. He was the sacrifice, not a high priest or a priest bringing something into the temple. They didn't want him in the temple. They had him thrown out. They arrested him by night. They went to the Romans and asked for the Romans to have him executed because under their laws, the religious leadership of Israel, they considered him a blasphemer because he had spoken about the things of God in the way that he said he was God. John chapter 8, verse 58, before Abraham was, I am. And now he has done the work so that all you need to do is to believe on Jesus as the payment for sin. The Messiah has done that. And as it is that be the case, look at verse 27, and as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. You're given one life to live here on this planet Earth, and you live it. In the scriptures, it says that 4 score and 10, as the Old English says, which is 3 score and 10, which is 70 years of age, and if matters be that you're given extra, perhaps 4 score and 10, 80 years of age. So you're given a certain lifespan here, and once that lifespan comes to an end, where do you go? Where does your soul and spirit go? Your physical body expires here, your soul and spirit leaves from your physical body, and God takes it to be takes you in your spirit and soul to be with him. And when he comes to physically call the church out of here, note what it says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. The dead in Christ will rise first. Those who have died as believers in Jesus will be called out of the ground first. I've heard it so many times. That old Bible joke, if I can call it, is that the dead in Christ have to rise first because they have 6 feet further to go to get out of the ground. God will open up graves, even if he might just translate whatever physical remains might be in each and every grave. There's going to be something behind. We know all about DNA and DNA markers. There are graves of people scattered all over the world who have died as followers of Jesus. And what is God going to do? He's going to resurrect their body. Some people have said to me, what if someone's been burned alive? Will he resurrect their body? Why not? If God can speak all of creation into existence simply by speaking, he can bring back the dead. What about someone who has been eaten by and destroyed by wild animals? Again, if God can speak all of creation into existence, why can he not resurrect someone like that? What have you been, people have been dead for 10,000 years and we don't know, and there's no grave marker, and how will God do this? Well, he's omniscient. He knows all things. He's omnipotent. He's all powerful. And he's omnipresent. He's everywhere. He does know where every single person is. He can even count the hairs on the top of your head. I always say with me, it's not that hard. The point is that God will bring those who are his people out of the grave. Once you die in this place here. Your physical life ends here, your soul and spirit with God, and then he is going to join together your soul and spirit with your renewed physical body, your resurrected body, which you're going to have for eternity. And you're going to be with God forever. And so you see, we are born, we die, then there's going to be the judgment. We as believers will come before the judgment seat of Christ, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, to give an account for our service for God. How are you serving God? If you're a follower of Jesus, you are called to be a servant for Jesus, to do something. I can't preach like this one, and I can't teach like that one. Well, you have a testimony. You can tell others about how you became a follower of Jesus. That's your one great sermon, if I can call it like that. Now, because it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment, look at verse 28, says to us as we conclude. So Christ, Messiah, was once offered to bear the sins of many. Unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. Now, this is important. Those who look for him, it literally means in the original language, eagerly wait for him. And he shall appear the second time without sin. That literally means there, without sin, apart from sin. That's the literal meaning of the word in the Greek. He is apart from sin. He has no place for sin. He has everything taken care of. He once offered to bear the sins of many. Who are the many? Anyone who turns to Jesus and asks to be born again. Those are the many. You may say, well, there's not a lot of manys. Where are they? Well, they're wherever they have been over the last 2,000 years of church history. In the previous 4,000 years prior to the taking away to Babylon and the 4,000 years prior to that, well, there has been time immemorial where people have died as people believing that God would keep his promise. Now remember, Abram, later renamed Abraham, received his covenant from God. And he was told that through him would come blessing to all the families of the earth. How could he have understood any of that at that time? I don't think he could have. But he believed it by faith. And because, as you will read in Hebrews 11 later on, because Abram, and later renamed Abraham, believed by faith, God accounted it to him as righteousness. Your account of being righteous before God has been paid by the one who offered himself, verse 28, to bear the sins of many. Are you one of the many? The many are those who put their faith in Jesus the Messiah, who came at the appointed time in history, in the appointed place, born in the appointed manner, dying ignominiously in the appointed way, as the payment for sin for any and all people who would call on him. He is without sin unto salvation. He is the only one who could bring a sin offering that could really give absolute forgiveness of sin, giving you salvation, eternity with God. If you know that because of him, we then are without sin because we have accepted the sin offering of Jesus. Now, does it mean that you won't sin? Sadly, we do by times. We sin. We make mistakes. We say things wrong. We think wrong. We act wrong. The thing is that God knows that. And because he knows that, he simply has instructed us, as John, one of the disciples, the apostles, told us in 1 John chapter 1, verses 3 through 10. If you say you have no sin, you're a liar, the truth isn't in you. But if you seek forgiveness of your sin and ask to be forgiven, I'm just paraphrasing all those verses up together. He, God, is just. He, God, is righteous. He, God, forgives. 1 John chapter 1, verses 3 through 10. It's an ongoing battle, you might say, on a daily basis, to live for God, to live for Jesus. You're going to make a mistake, perhaps. God knows that, and he provides a way back to him, simply by believing by faith. So what do you believe? Do you believe that Jesus is the Messiah? Are you a Jewish person looking in because you may have heard about these teachings online from a Jewish person telling you about Jesus? Perhaps you're looking at these things and you're saying that this person teaching is no longer Jewish because they no longer hold to Judaism. I like to refer to myself as a biblical Jew. And to that end, if you're interested to know how that can be, we have a brochure that speaks to how one can be Jewish and a follower of the Messiah. To be a Christian is not to have a religion. Christian, from the original Greek word, means follower of Messiah. Christianos, the predominant language of the world at that time, was Koine Greek. The Bible was written in Aramaic, and the Old Testament at that time in history had been translated to that, and then was translated into the Greek. And we have our Bible today in the English language and the various languages of the world. Do you want to know about these things? Well, if you'd like to read that brochure that tells you how this person became a follower of Jesus, my wife, the same thing, it's all in the same brochure. Email me at ron@ihopecanada.org and we'll be happy to send that along to you. Do you have a question about something we've taught or have said here? Send me an email also, same address, and just put on the subject line, question about Hebrews or Book of Acts, whatever it is that you're asking, or if you have just a general Bible question, I'll be happy to try and answer them for you. I'd like to mention to you that we are a faith ministry. We trust God to meet our needs and God's people to answer God's call to help meet those needs. And we're starting the new year and we're asking the Lord to send to us the funding that is needed for us to be able to act on a daily, weekly, monthly basis. The travels, the activities, the Bible studies in various and different cities, and everything else. It costs money to do these things. Perhaps the Lord might enjoin you to provide something to that. Go to our website, www.ihopecanada.org, and you can find there how you can donate. And if the Lord is drawing you to do that, we would praise God for that. Thank you. I'd also like to bring to your attention that we have started the process to organizing a teaching tour to Israel. We're looking to take that tour group in January of 2021. So if you are interested in this, details are being put together now. We'll know more about this in the coming days and weeks. I would appreciate if you are interested in a teaching tour to Israel, which I will be one of the teachers on. Email me again, ron@ihopecanada.org, and put on the subject line Israel 2021. And we'll be happy to be back in touch with you. And you can tell us, we can answer the questions of anything that you have. Thank you for looking in today. We appreciate every one of you who look in. Thank you for being part of this ministry in that way. Let's close our time in prayer and ask the Holy Spirit to direct us. Father God, thank you again today for everyone who has been here. We ask now that you'd bless the time you've given us and pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Until next time, Shalom.
And that's all, folks.